now we got 16 people on now. Of course, two of them are us, but still.
Three of them are us.
Oh, whoops, not watching.
Oh.
Arlie, it's cool with you if I just jump into the multi-crew stuff?
Sure, go right ahead.
I'll try and take a pause and breathe every once in a while so you can be able to jump in.
I've got it up on the RSI so I can follow along with you on certain areas. Everybody, we are coming back live. I believe everything should be working.
We shall see, sir, shouldn't we? Everybody, this is the Star Citizen Report, take two. This is December 13th, 2014, and I'm your host, Wupinyo. How's it going? I'm joined today by Arlia, on my right. I also have Spin, Double Lumi. And Spin is eager to talk about the multi-crew ships.
I'm jumping right in there, guys. We're not we can hear Whoop. Yay, we have victory.
Yay.
Unfortunately, when we were going through to get everything set back up so quickly, Whoop lost his notes, so I'm just going to jump right in on the multi-crew stuff, and then these guys are going to throw in their comments wherever they can. I promised them I'd stop and take a breath every once in a while. So what I would first want to say about multi-crew ships is that there's a number of ship categories that they talked about. Basically, there's the single pilot, you know, what we're flying in Arena Commander right now, so no stations. You just have the HUD for the pilot. Then there's capital ships, which are going to have stations that are dedicated to specific tasks, and those are the two extremes. So on this side, you've got single pilot. On this side, you've got the capital ship, and in the middle is the more complicated multi-crew ship, and that's right now covering everything from a Cutlass to the Carrick. And my understanding is the Carrick is the largest multi-crew ship, but I looked for the reference to that and I couldn't find it, so I'm pretty sure that's where it is, but I can't swear to it.
It's the largest for just below capital.
That's right. That's what I think it is. I think that everything larger than the Carrick is going to be a capital ship. Now, when we look at the ship specs, the 890 Jump and the Carrick are roughly the same size, so that puts the 890 Jump in a multi-crew position as well.
123 meters long, both.
Yeah, I mean, the 890 Jump is about 20,000 kilograms heavier, or mass. How would I say that? 20,000 kilograms more mass. It's not actually heavier. So the vision, multi-crew vision, this is where they start to talk about, hey, you know, the best science fiction movies are Firefly and Star Trek and Star Wars, and the coolest scenes are when they're all working together as a team. And that's the vision that they're going for. And Chris Roberts has talked about the whole time that the Constellation as a multi-crewed ship was the one he was looking forward to the most. And since he made those comments, they've expanded the number and styles of multi-crew ships. So I'm not sure if the Constellation is still his favorite, but I know that multi-crew ships, I think, is going to be the heart of Star Citizen in Chris Roberts' mind.
Looks awesome. I can't wait to get in there and do some co-op.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be very, very cool. Now, multi-crew, they said that their biggest challenge is one that's very common sense, which is to make sure the positions are fun for everyone to play and they make sense within the game. So you're not just wasting your time. You're doing something that's fun, that's contributing to whatever the team's goal is. You know, the specific question they ask is, how do they encourage people to be a navigator or an engineer? And I've played a couple of games where they work on this, and the last one was a Steam game, just a little one called Guns of Icarus, where you drive around in airships, and the engineer actually has, you know, a rubber mallet or a pipe wrench, and he goes and pounds on engines to fix them. And you know what? It was fun. It wasn't complicated enough, but it was fun. So I think this has got a lot of potential to pick out those stations that are going to give people a lot of enjoyment and make them feel like they're part of the team.
We have to get a bunch of more people in the grievance organization with Artemis. It's very similar to the way they're going to set it up, but it's like DOS versus this. So
yeah, yeah. I heard actually there's a lot of touch capability on the latest version of Artemis, so you can use it with iPads and things like that.
Yep. I'd like to try and get a good group together and possibly two ships and battle it out or work together. I prefer the co-op part, but whatever.
Well, you sent me that. I got that, the game.
Well, you need one version, one copy of the game to run the server, and then you need another copy for every person who's going to be playing it. So we need to be able to connect to the server host, whoever's going to be setting up the game with the different scenarios. You can even make your own scenarios. And you can dock at other ships, you can destroy enemies, you can go to other spaceports. And depending on which job that you want, you could even have multiple jobs. You just hit a different tab. It's pretty cool.
So the multiplayer ship, and I think they did mention specifically, not in this post, but I think it was in the dev tracker I saw where they talked about how they've looked at Artemis and what it offers to people, and it's one of the places they went for their research. Mm-hmm. They did mention specifically that this post was largely in response to questions about the Carrick. So we've got the Carrick to thank for all the information we're getting on multi-crew.
Yeah.
Crew stations, they're going to be a fixed size so that essentially the crew station is going to be the same size no matter what ship you've got. So they can have a standard in-game setup for the crew settings. And I think probably eventually they'll get to same as the HUDs where different ships have slightly different styles, but it's going to be basically the same. So you can go to any ship from any manufacturer and understand how the multi-crew station is going to work. Mm-hmm. They said it's going to be like the holo table. And then in the dev tracker, I specifically saw that they said, and we're fixing the holo table.
So thank goodness.
So it's going to be like a better version of the holo table. Because it is not the most user-friendly option. Mm-hmm. But like so many things, when I look back to Arena Commander from the first version to where we are now, what a massive change. And I think that people forget how far we've come sometimes.
And how far we have yet to go.
Absolutely. Now, one thing they said is the crew stations are going to be driven by the systems you install on board your ship. So if you don't put on the EWAR module, you're not going to have an EWAR capability on your multi-crew station.
It's electronic warfare.
Yeah, you have one particular character that only wants to do the one thing, so you remove the module. Like, oh, you can stand there.
That'd be my job. Wait.
And the other cool thing is they said that the bridge, like a command station, is going to be able to flick over to any of the stations. And I don't know if you're going to have the full capability to take over that station, but you'll have the ability to see what they're doing on that station. So if, you know, you go, what's going on with the power? We never seem to get enough power to our weapons. You flip over to power and he's playing Parcheesi on his crew screen, then you'll know who to yell at.
Galaga.
Exactly. So the action list, they've broken it down to kind of, it was a little difficult for me to grasp. So I had to read it a few times to get the full understanding of the crew station. Because they talk about the crew station, and then they talk about the action list. And the action list are, I don't think they're saying we are going to have all of these stations, but we're saying we're going to have these actions available on stations. And I don't think we know yet how they're going to organize it. And there's lots of time still to figure it out. And the first iteration is going to come out and we're going to have lots of suggestions and there's going to be lots of adjustments. We're pre-alpha. That's just part of the game. So I'm going to run quickly through the action list and talk a little bit about each of the main ones. The first one is shield management. And this one's kind of cool because they said there's three things that jumped out at me about this. Is you can use the shield management action to reinforce segments. And then the next thing that jumped out is segments, not just forward and aft. I think you could end up with more segments than that.
Oh, four sides. Yep.
Maybe more.
Well, it's supposed to be six if you go by all degrees axes, but yes.
Exactly. And there's also some ships that have more than one shield generator. So,
true.
You know, there's more information there. And then they talked about expanding the potential of your shield. So there are all sorts of possibilities of what that could mean. And well, I love the fact we're talking about S.H.I.E.L.D. in this sort of detail.
Well, you remember the stretch goals earlier in the year where we got the specific engine where you could overtune the engine, and same thing with the power plant and things like that. That's where it's really going to take a real good effect. You'll see like a 1 or 2%, maybe a plus 10 to armor, or plus 20 to shield, something like that. And you're able to apply that to certain parts or just overall, of course. You can only think about that right now. But that's where also the quality of the parts that you put in there. Like if you go with a Mark III versus a Mark V, you'll see a dramatic difference just on that screen.
Yeah, and then they talked about, you know, you're able to adapt the shield strength, the recharge rate, and the recovery time. And I went, recharge rate and recovery time? So I think that recharge rate is your shields are going down, you're pumping power in to bring back up, and then recovery time would be your shield's been all the way down, and how long does it take to bring it back up again? But that's just my guess.
Could be the capacitors.
Mm-hmm. It could be the amount that it gives out and the time difference, the delay until it gets in, increased.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that, you know, even just talking about shield management, which I think is one of the coolest ones we've got so far, is these are going to be further defined. So it's fun for us to talk about it, but we just have to be patient and wait till we go through testing and then define them and recognize that when the initial definitions come out, they are still going to be adjusted over the following year until they get to some place where not everyone, because we can't make everyone happy, but the vast majority of people are happy. So the next one on our list was radar ops. And what they talked about was you'd be able to identify targets, focus search for hidden targets. So that tells me stealth or targets that might be hiding in, you know, high noise areas. And you can flag targets that are particularly weak. Interesting, you can use the radar operation to scan subsystems on larger ships to figure out what status they're in.
Or target them.
Absolutely, to target them. And remember when they talked about boarding, they talked about you're going to have to disable those subsystems in order to put that ship dead in the water, so to speak, so that then you can conduct the boarding. And I'm sure someone's going to be trying to play possum. I know I would. And wait till the last minute when the boarding team's on the way over and then, you know, power up your weapons or power up your engines and ruin their boarding attempt. And the radar ops station, and I don't like the name radar ops as an aside because it's not just radar. It's, you know, the sensors are going to be more than that because we're detecting IR, you know, and electromagnetic.
Yeah.
Exactly. Not just a radar return from the surface of the vessel.
More like a spectrum.
Yeah, I just like sensor operations or something like that. Because we're going to have a multitude of sensors. They've already talked about it. I think they just default to the word radar until they, you know, get around to come up with something better.
Yeah.
The next one we've got is EWAR, electronic warfare. A couple of things jumped out at me here. One is they only talked about a radius effect. And I know that this is going to change because there's no way that you would want to pump out a radius effect at all times because you're going to affect your wingmen and, you know, miss out on some of the enemies. So I'm sure some of the things are going to be radius effect and some of the things are going to be targeted. Mm-hmm. But that's just my supposition at this point. They talked about dampening, disrupting, and disabling the enemy's systems. So dampening, reducing the range, disrupting them, making them less effective, and disabling them, essentially turning them off. And that's where we talked about, if you remember back 8 or 9 months ago, they talked about computer intrusions into enemy ships. And I think that's what we're talking about. So we're really expanding on what we have, what we would think of on electronic warfare today, into computer systems as well. And it's a natural progression that I think we're, you know, it's going to come for us too. The thing that really surprised me is they talked about debuffing, making the enemy more vulnerable. And that's something that, you know, they're using an MMO term, and I think eventually we'll get more information on that. We'll need to have more information on that. But it comes back to we'll just have to be patient.
Yeah. I think you're right.
Now we get into some of them that I think are part-time actions. They're not ones that we want to have a full station for. but they're things that would be interesting from time to time. Communications is one of them, and we really didn't get a ton of information about that. They talked about automated messages so that if you have a docking ring, you know, you'll have an option to send an automated message that says, hey, I would like to mate with you.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
What's that? Never mind. We're not going to touch that one. Thanks for that.
You know, a ship with another docking ring.
There's an action called docking that you don't want to know about.
Then we get into fuel, which is pretty it's not very exciting. You know, you can tell which tank you want to fuel with your hydrogen scoops, and you'll get more options if you're a ship that has a refueling arm. Okay. Scanning, I was kind of confused about that because how would we differentiate between scanning and radar operations? Mm-hmm. I think that scanning might be for anomalies. It might be for jump points. Yeah, for exploration. But then we also have a navigation action. And I'm like, well, wouldn't scanning for jump points fall under navigation? Or when would it be navigating? When would it be scanning? Mm-hmm. And I see some sort of combination where they get combined there. And the only thing we got for navigation is we use it for route planning. So, you know, you do it before you start
up. It shows fuel efficiency as well. It shows apparently the time that it's going to take for you to get to point A to point B.
And waypoints.
Like, yeah, waypoints. Yeah. And from point B to point C, you know, things like that. So it's route making, which GPS.
Yes. These action stations, from communications to navigations, power management, that's probably going to be a core item that's going to be available on every ship. Mm-hmm. The other ones, like EWAR, may not be on every ship, because if you don't put that module in there, or your ship can't fit it. Mm-hmm. Like if you're an Aurora, I mean, come on, let's be honest here. You know, you're just sitting on it.
Yeah, and you're going to get what you pay for too. Like some of the modules are going to be better, or what you'll see in the crew station is going to be better based on the module that you equip. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, if you've got the Mattel version of your power management, you know, you could have a 3 or 4 idiot buttons that say more power, less power, medium power.
Panic.
Exactly. Whereas, don't panic. You know, if you've got the version that they stripped out of an Audi, you're going to be going, okay, I've got a sliding scale here. I've got a number of sliders where I can adjust, mm-hmm. and I have a whole bunch of presets that I can hit for combat, for, you know, engaging the enemy, for defending. So I think there's going to be lots of options there. And this is just a taster. I think that's the most important thing I can say about the action list, is this is a taster of the kind of things we're going to see, because I don't think we've got everything covered yet.
Mm-hmm. No.
Some of the ones that jumped out at me that are missing is, you know, I think that probably we can look at power management, avionics, and CPU as an engineering style station, you know, combining those two actions. And I would also like to see damage control, because that's going to be a huge advantage on a multi-crewed ship versus, you know, the Constellation versus 3 Hornets, is the guys in the Constellation can actually conduct repairs while they're fighting. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And the Hornets don't have that option.
They were actually saying later on that they're going to have a 3D model, just like we can do online, and it'll show the damage areas. It'll show the EMP going through the electronic, whatever. It'll show your heat signature, everything like that. You can change it all at the workstation. You can see where you need to work, when and where and why.
Man, light support.
Don't get ahead of me, man.
Okay, I'm sorry. My bad.
But the life support that you mentioned earlier is the third one. Engineering damage control and medical/life support is, I really think, those are the three ones that jumped out at me that were missing off the list. I was also listening to another podcast, Tales of Citizens, which I really enjoy, and they were talking about flight control. But that's not a multi-crewed real requirement. That is more a capital ship requirement, and I bet we'll see it in capital ships. But in multi-crew, the most we're going to have is, you know, one snub fighter essentially on board, and, you know, you don't need a control station for that. It's going to be launch the fighter and recover the fighter, and those are your only two needs. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So I was going to talk next about the station interface. So those are actually you're seeing it up. You've seen a couple of pictures up in the live stream.
Yeah. And I get tired of seeing the same three pictures. I'm sorry. Go ahead. There's just so much to talk about, but they only show this so little.
It's true. But if you, Could you bring up Whoop, just the one picture of the actual station?
Which one were you seeing, the shelf or in the Freelancer or the guy standing next to it?
The close up on the screen that you see now.
Okay. I will single that out and I'll put that up in a sec.
Thanks, mate.
Yeah, no problem.
So we talked about, we know we're going to have stations and we know we're going to have actions, and we don't know exactly how the actions are going to be combined and which actions are going to be available on which station yet, but we do know roughly what each station is going to look like. And that's the station interface. And they were very careful to say each part has a function, there's no fluff, and each action will share information with other stations. So whenever you do something, the information is going to be shared across on a log. Now, the top of the display is the action shelf, is what they're calling it. And that shows all available actions that you have at your station. Now, some stations are going to have multiple options, some won't. In particular, they mentioned that command stations are going to have more options to use. And right under the action shelf is the ship statistics. Here's where we start to see the emissions. So your electromagnetic and IR emissions, with a secondary bar that tells you what the exterior EM and IR noise is like. And what I really like about that is it shows they're concerned about signal-to-noise ratio. And we saw it in a Bug Smashers a couple weeks ago, where they talked about how they were increasing the signal strength compared to the background noise, which tells me that we're going to have terrain in space. So there's going to be areas where there's higher noise ratio, so it's going to be easier to hide, and there's going to be areas where there's lower noise ratio, and you're going to stick out like a sore thumb, and
Kind of
you'll
like
it'll be harder to
submarines.
stealth. Exactly. It's
Like
making a ton of sense.
an asteroid will get in between there, and if you've seen the Transformer movies, the first one that came out, I don't want to say the first one, I want to say the first real live action one, whatever, they had a moment where the Decepticons blew up a signal, blew up a satellite, and it disrupted the signal so that the Autobots could not get it.
Well, what about if you have, like, say, a larger ship? Let's use the 890, for example, and you want to do like come up underneath it so that you can sneak in, and they don't see the signature of that fighter, and they just see that there's an 890 out there. You could cover that signature because of the larger profile.
Now, that was mentioned a few around the verses back, maybe three or four of them, and they said they weren't sure how it was going to work, if I recall correctly, but that that's a possibility that we would be able to hide smaller ships with lower signatures next to larger ships with larger signatures. So I think that's awesome.
If we can get really good at flying in formation, we can make all of our Hornets look like a 10, a nine, a 890 jump. That'd be awesome.
I remember it was in a 10 for the chairman, and someone asked a question to Chris Roberts, and he was talking about that. They asked about using the magnetic docking clamp on the bottom of a larger ship, and he said probably not the magnetic docking clamp, but you probably would be able to hide a ship in the signature of a larger one. So what Whoop was talking about earlier is the next thing I want to mention, and that's on the left-hand side. You can see the schematic view, and what we see right there is the default mode, which is nothing in particular highlighted. I think that's what we got. But basically, what you have is different view modes here. So the first view mode is what direction do you want to look from? And in that schematic, where you can see the 3D version of the ship, in the upper right-hand side, that's where you pick the direction that you want to look for, the direction you want to view the ship from. So there's top, bottom, front, back, left, right. And I'm not sure what the RS stands for in the middle. But you've got lots of options of how you want to view the ship. So if someone's behind you and they're shooting you in the engines, the guy who's doing the damage control could switch to the rear view so he could see exactly where the damage was and focus on that area. Then the display mode is along the bottom, and that's says sort of, oh, sorry, that's the component filters along the bottom, where you can say, I want to see the hull, I want to see the weapons, I want to see the system, or I want to see the propulsion or the shields. And you can click those on and off so you can focus on what you want to look at in particular. And then on the top left-hand side, it can give you the default mode, which is nothing highlighted. It can give you the power mode, which you can see is on right now, so you can see where the power is moving through your ship. Then there's also heat, EM, and damage. So you can see where those things are happening in the ship, and then focus in on them after that. And then you've got a bunch of presets along the bottom. So you can preset things up like we were talking about. Hey, I'm, you know, making a run on an unalerted enemy so I can just, you know, stick it to them. So I want to get maximum power to weapons, but I want to keep my IR and signature nice and low. So I want to watch those at the same time. Or I'm defending. I think it's a very, very good start.
I think it looks awesome. I can't wait to get my hands on it.
And the next thing I wanted to talk about was going forward. And they said that the multi-crew stations are going to feed into the capital ship stations. So they're really going to use all the information they're going to gain from testing the multi-crew and the community feedback into making the capital ship systems, which is exactly what we want them to do. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be increasing complexity, and it's going to be a challenge for them to balance how much complexity versus how much fun things are. And I'm confident they'll find it. It's just going to be a bit of a balancing act. And I've said it before, and I'll say it many, many times. We're just going to have to be patient.
Well, they were also talking about it's all going to be in Squadron 42, and they're actually planning to get it around the end of fourth quarter next year. So around this time, we should all be playing it in the single-player campaign.
That completes my 2 pages of notes on multi-crew ships.
Until next time.
Oh, gosh. Oh, that really is a big part, and we're all really excited about it. Those of us who are not very good at fighter piloting and dogfighting, we're looking forward to the big ships and being able to take down those little gnats, whatever.
Well, not only that, but you're also looking at the mining and the trade and everything else, and I'm sure there's going to be other components that are going to have a station in some of these ships. Mm-hmm. The Hull C has yet to come out, and that might be a capital ship because it is so large. Oh, and the 19th is the live stream for 4 hours. Yep. So those of you that are online and might be interested, it'll start at 10 p.m. Pacific or 10 a.m. Pacific for 4 hours live stream from CIG and RSI. So you go to their website and check in and see what they're going to do. Possibility, a true rumor that there might be a sale. We don't know.
I'd use the word term sale lately, but yeah.
Yeah. Very lightly.
It'll be available for purchase. It's not a discount.
Right.
Correct.
My guess is we're going to see the Mustang reveal because they just gave us the Mustang flare item and for the hangar. So I guess we're going to hear all the Mustangs. And I was checking out the Reverse the Verse. And I don't know if everyone knows, but after each Around the Verse, they do a Twitch stream with just a few people hanging around answering questions. And they are really informative and kind of fun. And they just sort of kick back and chill and chit-chat about things. There's a ton of information in there. And they're available. You can go back through them in Twitch on, I think it's called Star Citizen Community, but you can find it if you Google it or just go to Reddit, and there's a link on Reddit that'll take you there.
Now, we've been talking quite a long time, and we have a promise out there to give out a ship. We're going to give away one of those bundles that was out during the Black Friday or before the Black Friday sale, the Aurora package, the MR. It's a good chance to get your friends into the game if you want. Dash is handling the details, and I will personally send it to you. I'm going to need your email. But the winner of whoever gets it gets a ship. Woo!
Are we allowed to go in for it too?
You already have ships.
I'm not saying
but I'm
anything.
Giving them away.
Well, the thing is, it has beta access, not alpha access. So okay. The closest thing you have right now is the Arena Commander. So you can please play with your friends, get into it. This is a really good way to get people started in the game. We just got, 3,700 people, brand new accounts started?
7,400.
We passed the 66 million. This thing is growing, and the more people we get into it, the more people get to blow up. I mean, I get to hire. Yeah.
We get to play with.
Yes. There you go.
Toy with them.
And what if you go back to how they talked about the universe, is the universe population is going to be fairly static. Mm-hmm. It's, they don't know what the number is, but they plan to have a number. And the more players we have just means that more of those people are players and fewer of them are non-player characters. So we just want to get as many players in there populating the universe and doing crazy things for us all to be amazed at as we can.
Hooray, LTI.
Luminoff asked a question about the Mustang. Is it flyable? It's not in the arena commander or hangars yet. It's that's hopefully will be coming soon. The developers are practicing and doing what they're doing with on the race courses and everything else to work out all the bugs. How are we getting rid of this Aurora? What are the rules?
You can't win. I don't
No,
know if
I am not interested in winning. I have enough stuff in my hangar.
I honestly don't know. Dash is going to handle it. I don't know if he's doing
Oh, okay.
tickets or if he's doing like you put in a code or something. I can't see it on my screen because I don't have a second monitor yet. But when he tells you what to do, just do what he says. Do what he says, and you have a chance to win.
So, Whoop, your plan is just for stare at the chat and wait for Dash to put something in there?
Yes. That was the entire. Well,
Okay,
okay.
he's
Here it
starting the
is
ship
now.
gravel in 1 minute.
Okay. All right. There you go. Well, in 1 minute.
There are five Mustangs, by the way, five variants: Alpha, Omega, Beta, Delta, and Gamma.
You're doing it the
So,
complete opposite, but okay.
Omega is the free racer that people got with AMD, and then there's another racer. There's a military version,
That's the Delta. It's
the Delta.
the missile ship.
Okay, and I don't know what the other ones are.
The starter, the basic starter.
Alpha is the starter, and I think B is the Bravo. Can't remember if that's regular combat or if it's the racer. Omega is the racer, I know that one, but
Well, I think there's two racers because the
it's
Omega's a
probably Beta.
racer, and then they're going to have another one.
Different paint scheme. It's actually a different engine too. The Omega has a another engine in the rear,
Okay.
so it gives you a small advantage. But actually, we were talking about the arena commander, and a new part just got added, the gladiator. So, Arlia, please enlighten us.
We already did that.
Oh, we're going to do it again.
Okay. The Gladiator two-seat bomber is available at the Pledge store if you're interested, or you can wait until the Persistent Universe comes out where you can get it just for regular UEC credits. This bomber, are you going to show pictures? Oh, there it is. In the Revel and York hangar. This will be quick. It comes the around the ship. You can see that it has laser hard points, the bearings, I believe. Rick, Spin, help us out on this here. You know the weapons, the Klaus and Warner, what was it?
There's the Bering Mark IV and then the
That's it.
Klaus and Werner. Let me just look. I have it right here. So there's the Bering Mark IV laser cannon. So you got two of those under the wings. And then in the turret, you've got the Klaus and Werner 117 Badger Gatling.
Which is really nice to have. The seats for pilot and turret or second
Gunner, yep.
person, gunner, come down from below underneath the nose, and that we believe is where you eject. The top view looking down shows the cockpit in blue and the turret in red. And the red turret looks like you can eject through it for an emergency. It looks like it does have a cutaway. Whereas probably the pilot goes down and the other one goes up, so you can not all collide together, which
That
would
makes
be
sense.
smart. Yeah, that would be smart.
It's a really cool animation and how you get up and into the seat when you go into the pilot part. It brings you up and then it brings you back. And that allows time for the gunner seat to go up and then go up again. So you're actually sitting, what is it, two different heights, varying degrees. So the gunner really does get an open shot. They can see everything above, behind, in front. They can move around however they want. And the gunner, the pilot has a smaller view. It's kind of encapsulated. It's more, you can tell you're just going to be shooting straight ahead with the missile payloads. It's going to have the space to space and then space to ground, air to ground, whatever it's going to use. You can use the bomb bay, you can use underwing. It's going to have a huge weapons platform.
And
Yeah,
one of the
you notice the.
images,
Oh, sorry,
go
go
ahead.
ahead, Arlia.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, the size 5 torpedoes, the optional size 5 torpedoes in the belly, are I think they're the largest that we've seen so far. We haven't seen the retaliators yet. So this is going to pack quite a punch. And the other thing that I didn't mention before, when we talked about them working with Hornets, remember the Hornet tracker? They got all this additional scanning capability, but you know what? The pilot's got to do it all. I bet you could replace the turret in this with that tracking capability, and wham, you've got a guy who can, coordinate your squadron activities and focus the Hornets on a target, pick out the weak guys, increase your combat effectiveness. I think it's got tons of potential to work in concert with the Hornets.
A two-seater AWACS? Yeah, that'd be pretty cool.
The other thing, too, is it's also an atmospheric bomber, so it does have a PO tube, which is a long, narrow tube coming out of the nose section. And that is quite a very large PO tube for those that do not fly. PO tube is for airspeed indicator. The air comes in and with the pressure, and it tells you how fast you're going.
It's got a small profile when you're coming straight at it, too, so you're hard to hit unless you're coming from the top or bottom or side. But it's very reminiscent of the Cobra attack chopper in that respect, not all.
Mm-hmm. It's a good-looking ship, and you know what? I'm going to have to buy another one.
Well, they're available for a standalone ship if you already have your hangar. I believe they're 165 and 180 for the package. And in euros, it's less, but it's still in euros.
Less but more.
Yes, more.
It's a good-looking ship. I've liked it from the start, but I'm like, yeah, maybe I could do okay to Dogfighter. I was wrong.
I would think that this ship is not where you go out by yourself. You want to have a group with you. Mm-hmm. I mean, it is capable of dogfighting, but if you're carrying four torpedoes, you don't want to you want to get rid of those torpedoes first, then do what you need, because it'll cut down on the mass.
Hmm. Overall shots that it will give away are pretty awesome, though.
Yeah.
It's got a weapons system similar to a Warthog. It's got all those, I forget what they're called, under wing rockets and missiles and stuff like that. You're able to change them out. It's completely modular. You can change the guns for missiles. It said it's in the PDF file.
They're going to announce the winner.
Oh. Oh, yeah, cool. That's right. Somebody win.
We have 29 viewers.
Oh, cool.
There were 123 tickets entered.
Oh. But the entire ship is modular. Check out the PDF. Riley, could you post that in the chat, please? It's really detailed. It's great pictures. Great things to read about. This thing is, says like... enduring to a fault or something like that, gritty to a fault. It does look like it can take a few hits.
Congratulations to Lucy.
Yay, you.
Well done.
How many tickets did they buy? Never mind. It's okay.
I don't know. I'm just going too fast with everything. Okay. All right, Lucy.
I'll get with them after the show, and I'll get the email, and Lucy will get it.
Since he's a member with Grievance, I'm going to put up a link.
Cool. Good for you, man. There are also some other additions recently. Like, we got a wreath, and we got that new...
bar.
Yeah, the bar if you drink, and they added an animation, so that way it shows you being drunk. Drink or something.
I haven't found the wreath... the Christmas wreath in my hangar. Maybe I'm not looking in the right spot. Lucy, go to that link that I just put up for Grievance Pilot Roster. Fill in your information, and then when you go over to Grievance at RSI, you can apply. And if you're not already part of our Star Citizen organization, we could put you in, and once we have you in our roster. And congratulations once again.
Yeah, man. First thing I want to talk about is the stand for the Mustang. It says it's a Delta on the box, but it's on the Alpha slot.
Yeah,
I don't know if that's a bug or if... they're talking about giving you Alpha ships or Delta ships, whatever the models. The box I got was Delta, and I got the Alpha ship, whatever.
What I want to do when we get into the persistent universe is take all the boxes and pile them up against the wall somewhere. If that's possible, instead of just leaving them there by the stands.
Why don't you just throw away the boxes?
You haven't seen my house, have you?
No.
I want to clutter up this hangar that looks so pretty before, and like my house, so that people don't say, well, why can't you keep your house like you keep your hangar? No more problems.
Why don't you just leave the asteroid one? It'd be so much easier for you. There's oil spills already, man.
No.
Okay.
So, Whoop, do we want to move on to the monthly report?
Sure. Yeah, let's do that. That sounds like a great idea. Thank you, Sven.
We're also 20 minutes past the hour, just to let you know.
Oops.
Is there somebody coming on after us?
Yes, but it's WoW.
Okay, Lumi. So Lumi's got a question about, do we think 1.0 will still launch before the end of the year? They've been very careful about not giving us a release date for very good reasons. In fact, I'll paraphrase what the Travis Day said is, we learned our lesson when it comes to release dates, and now whenever we think it's a good idea to release to put out a release date, we walk down to a machine, we put a quarter in, and it punches us in the groin.
Why would you put a quarter in for that?
It's probably worth the investment not to put out a release date. Now, that said, they talked about Around the Verse the last time, how they're working a crunch to try and get it ready before Christmas. And I don't know if they're going to make it or not, but they're working very hard to make it. So I think that if it doesn't come out before Christmas, it'll come out mid-January.
Yeah.
I think you're pretty good in that.
Everything patience, just be patient. It's better that they have it working than not. We are all used to it. All of us are gamers. You buy a game and you have to wait for a patch a couple weeks later. Let's not have to go that route from publishers. These CIG and RSI, they know what they're doing.
If you're going to
do it right. They're putting out a very good product each time. Mm-hmm. There's been a few minor things that they slid on. But generally, every patch has been a good progress. And coming from ArcheAge, where every second patch is a disaster, I'm pretty appreciative of the effort they're putting into it.
Mm-hmm. Working content, updates that actually mean something, not just fixing bugs, that's great. You put out something that works well, always do that. The internet is full of anonymity, and we're all very like vultures, and we swarm like locusts, too. So, keep that away. Do a good job. We'll all be happy.
Okay, I'm going to quickly run through the November monthly report. I recommend people go to read it because there's tons of good information in there. But missiles in the signature system overhaul, which is we talked a little bit about the signature system overhaul. I'm really looking forward to it. But the fact is a whole bunch more missiles are coming out along with not this Around the Verse, but the previous one they talked about, you know, not only are we going to have weapons cameras, but you're going to have a chaff camera so you can fire off your chaff and then look through the chaff camera and see if it has seduced the missile away from you, which is going to be awesome, especially for streaming and, you know, putting together some fantastic Star Citizen videos. The new weapons, missiles, and items are going to be introduced with 1.0. They finished the newest ship commercial, so we should see it at the live stream, and my guess is the Mustang, and with all its variants, which should be a great video, I think.
I thought they were doing the Avenger, or is that the...
Ventures they're working on too.
Okay.
Well, they said they didn't say one release. They said reveals. Okay. So I don't know whether that's going to be ships, more than one ship, or ships and weapons, or ships and weapons and systems, or some combination thereof. We just have to wait and see. It's only less than a week away. They talked about the Carrick construction. They talked about Arc Corp, and the next project is Terra Prime. So Arc Corp is essentially done. So the corporation city, and Terra Prime is supposed to be one of the biggies. So they've learned some lessons from Arc Corp, and they're headed up to one of the jewels of the Star Citizen universe, Terra Prime.
Terra is beautiful. Mm. You know, if you live on Earth, you want to move to Terra. If you live on Terra, you don't want to ever go to Earth.
The first Lawless system, Delmar. So the landing spot in Delmar in the Nyx system, and that's going to be the Lawless zone, and they're figuring out what the balance is going to be to allow it to be fun and exciting and dangerous, but you're still able to go and get some stuff done. And Beery mentioned he'd love it if it was a Retaliator commercial. Yeah, that's too much to hope for, buddy. I would love it if it was Retaliator, but I don't hold out hope for that. I would just end up being crushed if it didn't turn out to be that. Another thing they're working on is the ability to invite people to your hangar. So that should be coming out with 1.0. Nothing's been promised on that, but I think we'll see it in 1.0. They talked about Squadron 42, the Vandal, and the UEE capital ships in the production pipeline. They mentioned in a Reverse the Verse talking about the Corvette, and that the Corvette is underway, but it's still in the concept development phase, if I understand it correctly. Gladiator is out in the hangar. The Gladius is almost ready, so I expect we'll see that in 1.0. The Idris and Javelin capital ships are going to be Squadron 42, but they're still working on the interior, so I don't think we'll see those for us to look at until after Chapter 1 of Squadron 42 is released. And just as a reminder to people, Squadron 42, we're only getting Chapter 1 early in 2015, and there's going to be 10 chapters. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's probably around March, maybe.
Yeah, it'd be nice. March would be a nice time frame.
Mm-hmm.
They're improving the damage effects. So better quality smoke, better quality fire inside the ships, explosions, interior and exterior. And some people say, well, you wouldn't see an explosion in space. I'm like, well, but you'd have the releasing of the air that contains oxygen. It would be going to space. You could see flame. Plus, it's just fun. So sometimes just roll with it.
Yeah, the one thing that you always need to consider is Apollo 13, the actual Apollo 13, and the explosion that they had with their oxygen tanks. And then you see it in the movie and the debris and everything else. So, yes, you are going to have that. One thing they were talking about on the microgravity and zero gravity in one of the discussions was that as good as SIG is making this, it is just too much detail to go through and move the smoke when it's in zero G. So if it looks static, fine. Let it just ignore it. I mean, there's only so much they can do.
But I bet they'll get to it eventually.
Oh, yeah.
You know, CR loves his immersion.
Mm-hmm.
After he's done inventing a way to put two people on a ship that's moving. Yeah.
We'll talk about it later. Yeah, we've talked several times about, you know, how we're going to have different manufacturers are going to have different kinds of HUDs. And now we're talking about different manufacturers having different tones and tones of voice and voice styles for it to go along with their HUDs and the warnings. And they mentioned, you know, aliens will do their own thing. So I could see some crazy alien things where it sounds to us like a question, but really it's saying missiles incoming or... The ship will self-destruct in 10 seconds.
It'd be cool if we could also use in-game credits to change it as well, to change the AI voice. That'd be awesome.
I'm 100% positive that we're going to be able to mod that, and you'll see the community coming in with a whole bunch of different things, just like they're doing with voice attack.
Yep.
I know we'll get there eventually.
That's awesome. I can't wait to get in there.
Do you feel that maybe SIG RSI might say, look, let's incorporate voice attack into the game, or instead of making people go out as a third party, somehow do it?
I bet they would like to do it, but it also means, you know, what's proprietary to voice attack, what isn't, and I'm just pulling this directly out of my butt at this point as, you know, what the possibilities could be. But CR is big into modding. And essentially, voice attack is like a mod for the game. So I don't think that he would override it. I think he would spend his time focusing on things that third party can't do.
Beer Ye 2542 mentioned that the larger ships, the Idris and larger, might be available on Arena Commander 3, which should be out before Squadron 42. But what part of Squadron 42? Are we talking the full thing, which is at the end of 2015? Because the game is going to be sometime around 2016. We don't know when 3 is going to drop.
As far as the information we've been given so far, I don't think that's right, Beery, because you're right that Ben said the Idris and bigger ships will be looking at Arena Commander 3.0. But there was also some question about whether or not they would be in Arena Commander or whether it would be in their own simulator. I know that discussion was happening. And I think that'll be before the entire Squadron 42 is done, but it won't be before Chapter 2 is released. Chapter 2 is going to be released, or Chapter 1 is going to be released, I mean, before Arena Commander 2.0.
I like how the Vandal Swarmer has 18 waves now.
Oh, boy.
I haven't got past 10. I suck at the game.
Yeah, Lumi, I know they talked about it. It's just my guess saying that, you know, if a third party is providing a software that does the job, why would we spend our development time on that rather than on something that a third party guy can't do? But I haven't, like you said, it was some months ago, and I haven't heard anything recently about it at all. And I think that if they were going to do it, we would be hearing about it. But you never know. So everyone saw, or hopefully everyone saw, the FPS system and, you know, the initial look at Zero G, and the initial look at Zero G was pretty impressive. And they've already made a whole bunch of changes and improvements to FPS, not only to Zero G, but the cover system, and the feedback on the cover system is really good. So essentially you walk up to cover, and I'm sure there's a setting in there, but essentially you automatically will go into cover if you're next to cover. And then you can break out of the cover to do something.
Okay. I also saw the PDF about the different weapons and how they came to be. The top of the weapon has to have more geometry to make it more appealing for us. They had the different assault rifles with the two different powers, power supplies. They had the electric shotgun, stuff like that. In the Arc 2 pistol that you can buy for $5 separate, and it comes with the Super Hornet package, if you originally got that. They had work on that, and that looks pretty sweet too.
And cool, guys, do you want to keep going into the Around the Verse and the 10 for the Chairman?
I think we're gonna eat up too much time on this.
We can discuss we're going to discuss on the 27th. Let me put that up for the people in there.
This was a huge news week, and with the multi-crew and I you know, got excited and used up lots of time. but next week, I don't think we're going to – well, actually, next week we're going to have the live stream, so –
it's not next week. It's the following.
It's the 19th. The 19th at 10 a.m. Pacific time and for 4 hours at RSI.
So when's our next cast going to be then?
27th. We're after Christmas, before New Year's Eve. We'll be here at 1800 hours Central, or 0000 hours UTC. So, yeah, I know.
You find new ways to amaze me every day.
I've been using the old GMT UTC for years when I used to work in banking. I would like to thank all of the people who were very patient to this evening with our show and our cast.
And that's my fault. I got a new headset and I didn't have everything set up. It's completely my fault.
It's not your fault. The baby was in your lap and yanked something. But
but thanks for sticking with us. We'll be with you next time. And as always, thanks, guys.
Cheers, guys. Have a great night.
Happy holidays. Take care.